Messiah stand. To take a stand.
Stand.
Not knowing I'd lose my best friend.
Stand.
But I'd rather live right
stand.
Than in hell lift up my eyes.
Stand.
All God's children just stand. Tell somebody, say,
you stand.
Yeah, Lord, yeah. Stand for holiness.
Stand for holiness.
Whoa.
Stand for righteousness.
And be counted,
among them that shall reign with him.
Decided to take a stand, not believing at least some of my friends. And I would rather, I'd rather live right than in hell lift up my eyes. All of God's children just stand, stand. Everybody saying,
you stand.
Oh, stand for holiness.
Stand for holiness.
Oh,
stand for righteousness.
And
be counted among them that
surrender.
Surrender.
Stand. Oh,
stand
when
friends are gone. Stand when you're all alone.
And believe we shall receive his own. Stand for holiness.
Stand for holiness.
Stand
for righteousness.
And the counting
among them that shall reign with him.
I'm gonna be in the number.
Yeah. My friends are gone. Stand
all
alone.
All alone.
And believe
he's coming back to get us.
His
oh, stand for holiness.
Stand for holiness.
And
be counted among them that surrender with
him.
Stand.
When
friends are gone. Stand. When you're all alone.
And believe
it
shall
receive.
Everybody stand up and say.
Stand.
For holiness.
For holiness.
Oh, for righteousness.
And
be counted
among them that
gonna do it now. Point to somebody, say, you stand. Hallelujah. Clap your hands, everybody. Clap your hands, everybody. Hallelujah.
Stand.
Not knowing I'd lose my best friend.
Stand.
But
I'd rather
live right
stand.
Than in hell lift up my eyes.
Stand.
All God's children just
stand.
Yeah.
Stand.
Tell somebody, say,
you stand.
Yeah, Lord, yeah. Stand for holiness.
Stand for holiness.
Whoa.
Stand for righteousness.
And be counted,
among them that shall reign with him.
Hey, whoa.
Stand.
Hey,
when friends are gone.
Whoa. Amen. Amen. I am Elder Stephen Thomas, preparing to teach our Sunday school lesson on today, the second Sunday in April. Amen. As we stand for righteousness, which is coming right in line with our lesson today about what Ezra did. Amen. We certainly appreciate you all choosing to study with us and to worship with us as we go through God's word on today. And again, we do not count it lightly that you would take the opportunity to be a participant with us as we try to share God's word. Amen. Again, we bid you welcome from here at St. James Cumberland Presbyterian Church in America, here in Decatur, Alabama. And we thank you for joining, and whether you are in Decatur or anywhere in the state of Alabama, the United States of America, or wherever you are on the planet, again, we bid you welcome. As we preparing to go into God's word, we ask that the God's Holy Spirit will be one in the midst. Whatever time we are recording, whatever time we are studying and viewing this, that God is everywhere at the same time. God is not limited by time. He's way in the past and he's way in the future. Amen. We serve an omnipotent God. So may we pray and ask God to lead us down through his word. Amen. Our Father in heaven, Lord, we thank you. We thank you for this, another opportunity to share your word. We thank you for this opportunity that we may come and be bound together. Even though, Lord, we may not physically be together, but Lord, we know that your spirit, your Holy Spirit, it runs from heart to heart, from breast to breast. And Lord, help us all to get on that one accord where we may learn about you, where we may be able to rightly teach your word, where we may be able to understand your word and understand what you would have us to get out of this lesson. God, we thank you so much for being God all by yourself. Thank you so much for loving us so much so that you gave your darling son to pay a ransom for us that none of us could pay. God, we thank you again for touching us this morning with a finger of love and allowing us to see another day, to see a day that we have not seen before, nor shall we see again. And God, we thank you for the many healings that you've done. Thank you for blessing. Thank you for touching. And God, we have some sick among us and we have some bereaved. God, we're asking you to please comfort, touch, and heal as only you can. And Lord, we'll be careful to give you all the honor and all the praise. God, we ask that you please lead us down through the treasures of your word, that we can learn it, Lord, that we can rightly explain it, and that we can then live your word. God, this and many of the blessings we ask in your son, Jesus the Christ's name. Amen. Amen. As we look at our lesson today on the second Sunday in April of the year 2021, our lesson title is Ezra, Faith and Action Preacher. Amen. And our Bible background is, and the printed text is Ezra chapter 10, verses 1 through 12. And our aim for change. By the end of this lesson, we will contrast the people's need for repentance with their joyful response to God's word. Believe that God's truth is eternal, and grow in determination to serve God in our community and beyond. The keep in mind, and Ezra the priest stood up and said unto them, ye have transgressed to increase the trespass of Israel. Now therefore make confession unto the Lord God of your fathers and do his pleasure, and separate yourselves from the people of the land. And this is from Ezra chapter 10, verses 10 through 11. Amen. Now, as we look at our lesson is going to encompass, it's from the book of Ezra, but we're going to study a lot of chapter 9 and 10. Chapter 9 leading up into 10, where as we're studying our lesson, we have to go back and get an understanding as what is transpiring here. We recall that the prophet Jeremiah had promised and had prophesied that God was going to raise up
a nation that was going to overthrow Israel because of all the sin that Israel did. God was going to allow this nation, the Babylonians, to come in and to overthrow them, but God would still leave a remnant. God said that after 70 years, they will come back and that God will then restore Israel. And true to fact, just as God had declared, Isaiah had even called his name in the 44th chapter, the last verse of the 44th chapter, and then right there in the 45th chapter of Isaiah, well, they called his name Cyrus. And Cyrus being the king, when he overthrew Babylon, he then allowed the children of Israel to come back and to rebuild the temple, as God had said that they would. And as time would go on, that was Zerubbabel, who was the leader who came back and they built the temple. Now, as they started to build the temple, God, there are always people who are trying to hinder God's plan. They had people there who were trying to stop them, to where they even wrote back to the king and told another king after Cyrus that these people are trying to rebuild the temple and these people here are rebellious people and they won't pay any tributes to you and all the things. And so as time would go on, it stopped it for a little while, but God is God. When God says something is going to happen, it is going to happen. So as time went on, they did finish the temple. Amen. And as they had finished the temple, and over time, which is where we're going to pick up now with Ezra. Now, Ezra was a priest. Ezra being a priest, and he was also called a ready scribe. A ready scribe means not just was he able to write down and to know the scriptures, but he studied the scripture and he was able to teach the scripture. He would be able to understand the scripture and then share so that people would have the right understanding of what God was saying. So him being a priest and a ready scribe, he knew God's word. And as time would go on, he was allowed by the king, Artaxerxes, to come back to Jerusalem and there to worship. And when he was coming back, he then, Ezra, the king had given them a lot of treasure, something that would be an equivalent of today of like $20 million, and a lot of gold and silver and all the vessels that had been taken away from Israel under Nebuchadnezzar. It was all still there over this time, and this new king allowed them to take it all back, and they were going to travel on the road, and Ezra prayed to God, and he prayed to God that they would have safe travels with all of these treasures, and God made the pathway just smooth where no one troubled them, and they came all the way back, and then he counted it to them there at the temple, and so that they then were able to take an inventory of all the treasures going back into the temple. And so as they are doing this, Ezra is talking to them, and he's sharing. And then the people came and they started to tell Ezra what has transpired. And what has transpired is that during this time of the people having left captivity and coming back to Jerusalem, in that window of time, as I shared with you about the time that the temple, there was a little stop, a pause in the temple, and then the completion of the temple, however number of years this was, the people have sinned and they have gone and taken on these foreign wives. And foreign wives does not mean wives from somewhere else. These foreign wives were wives who had foreign religions. These were the religions of the people in the land that God had told Israel to drive them out. And we know, because I've spoken about how the king, like we even talked about King Ahab, who had that wife Jezebel, who had all of her false gods and all these things. And here the children have come back from captivity, and they have now started to go back and to marry these people. But please take it, and we will talk about this later on. But these marriages are not the real marriages. And what I mean by the real marriage is that when God had told them to not even intertwine and mix in with these people, because these people, these foreign religions, will turn them from God. And then when they would marry them, this was not a legal marriage that they were doing. They were just living together. Whatever they were doing, they were doing. Amen. I leave it there. But it was not a real marriage. Yes, they had children and all that, but That was not part of it, the way God had planned, because God wants them to be, for all the people to only worship and serve him. So that's what we're going to pick up today with Ezra chapter 10. And we're going to start off with verse number 1, and we're going to go down from verse number 1 down through verse number 6. And it reads, "Now when Ezra had prayed, and when he had confessed, weeping and casting himself down before the house of God, there assembled unto him out of Israel a very great congregation of men and women and children, for the people wept very sore. And Shechaniah, the son of Jeriel, one of the sons of Elam, answered and said unto Ezra, we have trespassed against our God and have taken strange wives to the people of the land, And yet now there is hope in Israel concerning this thing. Now therefore, let us make a covenant with our God to put away all the wives and such as are born of them, according to the counsel of my Lord, and of those that tremble at the commandment of our God, and let it be done according to the law. Arise, for this matter belongeth unto thee. We also will be with thee. Be of good courage and do it. Then arose Ezra and made the chief priests and Levites and all Israel to swear that they should do according to this word, and they swear. Then Ezra rose up from before the house of God and went into the chamber of Johanan, the son of Eliashib, and when he came thither, he did eat no bread nor drink water, for he mourned because of the transgression of them that had been carried away." Amen. Now we will go back into and look at verse number 1. As I was sharing earlier, that when King Xerxes gave Ezra the letter, he gave him a letter. And this letter was a letter of authority that made him in charge, that whatever he declared, he had the power and the authority to appoint judges, to handle cases, to handle all matters, whatever he needed to do, whatever he was required to do to control the law or whatever. Ezra was in charge. He had all of the authority there of the king as he was when he got there to Jerusalem. So now, as we look at verse number 1, as I was sharing earlier, the people had come and they had shared with Ezra that the people had started to intermingle with the people of the land that were living there. They had joined them in together. And one of the people, as they came, and they shared that it wasn't just all the people, it was even all of the leadership, the priests and the Levites and stuff, had done these. I believe that's what they said, was the priests and the Levites had said that was in chapter number 9. And so when Ezra heard this, Ezra tore his clothes. And then that's a sign of mourning. And so he tore his clothes. And so we're now picking up with chapter 10, verse number 1. It says, "Now when Ezra had prayed, and when he had confessed, weeping and casting himself down before the house of God." He is there at the temple. He, like I said, he was a priest, and he had gotten the word, and he tore his clothes, and he was praying. He bowed down to God on his knees with his hands stretched forward, and he just couldn't even look up to God because the sins were so great. He shared that the sins were over their head as far as what all they had done. They had come and had mixed the holy seed with the people there in the land, what God had specifically told them not to do. Now, Ezra knows what the consequences are because he is one of the people that has come back from captivity. He is one that has been a slave over in Babylon and has now, as God has declared, that God has given favor to the Israelites, and God had made the king over there to the new king to allow them to leave. And so Ezra has been crying, as it says here. He prayed, and then he had confessed, weeping and casting himself down before the house of God. There assembled unto him out of Israel a very great congregation of men and women. and children. So we now, with Ezra coming in, remember I shared that he had all of the authority of the king of the king that had overthrown the Babylonians. He came over with all the authority of Xerxes. They had seen that the king had blessed him and had given him all of the treasures for him to come and put it back there into the temple, and that he had the letter of authority. And so here he is, even though he has this might, power, and authority, he is God's man. He is a man of God. He is, as I stated a moment ago, a priest and a ready scribe. So he knows what this means when we understand that the people have continued and have gone back to sinning. And so he prayed, and as he prayed and cried and confessed, there's a large crowd around him of men, women, and children. And as they are there, and the people then started to weep also, because they are starting to understand just what this means. We have already done wrong. God had punished us, and now God had also told us that he would allow us to come back after 70 years, and the time has passed, and we have now been coming back. We now have our temple back up, and we are doing it, but then as we look at it, we are still falling back into that sinful state that God had punished this foreparents before. And so the people then are starting to realize and know that they are in trouble because they have been and are transgressing God's commandments. Verse number 2. And Shechanahan, the son of Jeriel, one of the sons of Elam, answered and said unto Ezra, we have trespassed against our God. And this trespass here means we have sinned against our God and have taken strange wives of the people of the land. Now, these strange wives here, this means these strange wives, they're not wives that look different. We're not talking about a racial thing. We're talking about people who have a different religion. They are servants. These women, these three strange wives, were wives that were serving false gods. They were pagans. They were idol worshipers. And here they are, they have taken them as wives. God had told them in Deuteronomy, do not take any of them as your wives. Do not give your daughters to them to be their wife. Do not take their daughters for your sons to be your wives and your daughters-in-laws. Keep them separated, because the people, as we recall, let's go back. God had given them the land because the people who lived in the land were doing all manners of evil. We recall the Canaanites and all that. And so that lets us know that it's not the people, it is the religion that they were serving, because we know about Rahab. She became, you know, when she did what? She came over there and she accepted and she became a Jew. We also know, just like with Ruth and Naomi, same thing. So here, it is not the people, it is the religion that they are doing. And so as it says here in the middle part of verse 2, it says, and that they have taken strange wives of the people of the land. We know that the Amorites, the Canaanites, the Moabites, all of those people there who have these different gods, they took those women and took them to be their wives, and they are strange wives. And then last part of verse number 2, he said, now, and as we look here, we're listening to the person that is talking to Ezra. Ezra is brokenhearted. He knows what has happened. He knows that he is one that is coming back from captivity, and he knows what, and being a ready scribe and understanding God's word, he knows what it means when the people are sinning. But we also have someone here who is now going to do some encouraging for him. And as we look at this, and he's looking, we look at verse number 3. The latter part of verse number 2, I'm sorry. And it says, yet now there is hope in Israel concerning this thing. Here is someone who is going to, he is encouraging the priest. He is encouraging Ezra. Ezra knows and understands what it looks like, but here we have someone who also knows and understands. He says, and yet we know that we have done things, but there is hope in Israel. There is still hope. What he is basing everything on is the loving nature of God, the forgivingness of God, the kind mercies of God. how God will have mercy, but they must do something. You know, God loves us. God cares about us. When we get right and come and worship him, God is standing there with open arms to welcome us back. And here we have someone who realizes and who is encouraging and says that there is still hope in Israel concerning this thing, concerning the sins that they have done. There is still hope. It's just like us. There is still hope. As long as there's breath in our body, there is still hope. God will save just as Jesus did. He saved us, the thief on the cross. Amen. So God will save as long as there's breath in our body. God is able to save. So verse number 3. As we're going forward, he says, now therefore, and verse number 3 says, now therefore, let us make a covenant with our God to put away all the wives. This person in number two, Shekinahan, I'm going to miss it, man. Shekinahan, I'm sorry. Therefore, he said to let us make a covenant with our God to put away all the wives and such as are born of them, according to the counsel of my Lord, and of those that tremble at the commandment of our God. What he is sharing here is that if we make a covenant, if we turn back to God, if we ask God for forgiveness, and then we repent and we show that we have made a difference, that we have made a change, God is a loving God, and God will move. God will have mercy. And so it says that if they go and they make a covenant, now we understand a covenant is a promise, that they're going to make a promise to God, that they're going to put away all these wives. Lord, we've done wrong. Lord, we've been doing wrong, and God, please forgive us. We know that what you have told us to do, which is not marry these women, and we have done that, but God, we're going to put them away. We're going to turn from them. We're going to push them back. We're not going to even have them around us, because they're going, that the religion that they're studying and that they are doing, not studying, that they're practicing, or whatever the right word is, it is not of God. And Lord, we don't want to do anything that's going to harm our relationship with you. And he says, not only are they going to put away their wives and such as born of them, even the children, because those wives will have those children doing the same thing. We know how Jezebel did when she had got with Ahab, how she turned all things around. So they're saying that they're going to put away them and those children, according to the counsel. And counsel is discussion of my Lord, talking about whatever Ezra say. Ezra, you are a priest. You are a ready scribe. If you just share with us what we should do, we certainly will do it. And they said they're ready to make a covenant with them, and of those things that tremble at the commandment of our God, and of those that tremble at the command of the God of our God. Meaning that those of us who fear God, those of us who worship God, those who have reverence to God, we tremble, and so we know that we will do what God would command them to do. And he said, and let it be done according to the law. And so after that, verse number 4, arise for this matter belong, and he's encouraging him to Ezra to arise, because this matter belongeth unto thee. Remember a moment ago I shared that the king Artaxerxes had given Ezra a letter of authority that had everything under his control. Remember, I shared that Ezra was able to appoint judges. He was able to determine the laws. He was able to share who would do things, even any kind of measure of punishment. Ezra was able to do all of these things. So that's why he says in verse number 4, arise, for this matter belongeth unto thee. Whatever you say, however you say we should do, that's what we are going to do. And he also said, we also will be with thee. Now he is pledging his allegiance to him, because he knows that Ezra is a man of God. He knows that Ezra is following God, and he's given us the right instructions that God would have us to do. And he is saying, I'm on your team. I'm going to do whatever you say, because I know that you are following the Lord. And so he is already making his declaration as far as what he's going to do. And so he told him, arise, for this matter belongs unto thee. We also will be with thee. We're going to be with you. We're not going to try to undercut you. We're going to be with you. And he told him, be of good courage and do it. I know that you're injured. I'm injured meaning that you're heartbroken. I know that you are grieving for us. I know that you have despair, and that you because of the concern of what we have done, and you know that we have done wrong. But be of good courage. We're going to do better. We are going to turn around, and God is going to forgive us, because his nature is that he is a loving God. And now, verse number 5. Then arose Ezra and made the chief priests, the Levites, and all Israel. Now notice what it says. He grabbed the chief priests and the Levites first. He started with the leadership. You know, however the leaders are doing, that's what the people would do. Because as I shared earlier, when they came and told Ezra about that the people had sinned because of they had been mixing and with the people who lived around, had taken on these wives, these strange wives, and how they had mixed the holy seed of Israel with them. And so as we are now looking here, he started with the chief, with the chief priests and the Levites. He started with the leadership. And also, as I was stating, as I was about to state, when they came and told Ezra that, they even told him that the chief priests and that the priests and the Levites were the main ones or were the chief among them who were doing this particular, these manners of evil. So now, and that's in chapter 9. So now, as Ezra is looking and he called the chief priests and the Levites, and then he called all of Israel. I wanted to bring the point that he's calling all of the leaders first, bringing the leadership in, because as people see the leaders, then the people will follow whatever the leaders are doing. If the leaders are doing crooked things, then people will start doing crooked things. If the leader is doing good things, then the people will do good things. We know that because of the history of Israel. When they had a good king, the people did good. And when they had a bad king, the people did evil. So now, as the chief priests and Levites and all of Israel, Ezra had them to swear that they should do according to this word. They had to make they had to swear that they would put away all these strange wives and all those born of the strange wives. And they all sweared. And so they made a commitment. They made a swear. They made a covenant that had been requested and recommended. And so they have now done that. And verse number 6 says, after they had sworn that they were going to do it, they were going to go and put them away. Then verse 6 says, then Ezra rose up from before the house of God and went into the chamber of Johanan, the son of Eliashib. And when he came thither, he did eat no bread nor drink water. He went into a fast. He went into a fast and he is praying, asking God's forgiveness, praying, asking God for the wisdom and the leadership of what to do, and asking God to please have mercy. So he is fasting and praying to do this right here. For he mourned because of the transgression. I shared earlier that he tore his clothes when he found out the news. And he stayed down there and he was crying and weeping until the third hour of, I mean, not third hour, until the evening sacrifice, I'm sorry, which is around 3 p.m. So we now have it. And for he mourned because of the transgression of them that had been carried away. When he says he mourned for the transgression of them that had been carried away, the ones, as I shared earlier, the people had to come back from Babylon. And when they came back from Babylon, they came in and they came back to Jerusalem, but God had already promised them that he would send back a remnant. But now they act as though they do not recall that they have been sent away, that they had been captured and taken taken over to Babylon. And so the people who had been part of that is, you know, it's just like if we've been caught into a bad situation, we certainly should not be manipulated and fall into the same trap or the same hole again. If we know that that is a hole there, we tend to walk around it. And so this is what Ezra has been praying about, because Ezra was able to tell the people, and the people should know and remember, that the reason that they were taken over into Babylon was because of the transgressions against God, as far as the sinning that they had done, with the worshiping of all the false gods. God had told them that he was going to raise up a nation to get them to turn back to him. God is a jealous God, and the people would still go forward and do those things. And so that's why Ezra is still weeping and about the transgression of them that had been carried away. You know, it is as though they do not remember, or that they didn't learn the lesson that God was intending for them to learn. And so Ezra was then mourning for them. So now we will pick up with the remainder of our study today with verses 7 through 12 of chapter 10 of Ezra. And they made proclamation throughout Judah and Jerusalem unto all the children of the captivity, that they should gather themselves together unto Jerusalem, and that whosoever would not come within 3 days, according to the counsel of the princes and the elders, all his substance should be forfeited, and himself separated from the congregation of those that had been carried away. Then all the men of Judah and Benjamin gathered themselves together unto Jerusalem within 3 days. It was the ninth month, on the 20th day of the month, and all the people sat in the street of the house of God, trembling because of this matter and for the great rain. And Ezra the priest stood up and said unto them, ye have transgressed and have taken strange wives to increase the trespass of Israel. Now therefore make confession unto the Lord God of your fathers, and do his pleasure, and separate yourselves from the people of the land and from the strange wives. Then all the congregation answered and said with a loud voice, as thou hast said, so must we do. As we are looking at verse number 7, not only after Ezra had told the chief priests, the Levites, and the people that were there around him when he got the news, and when the people who had promised, who had sware that they were going to put away the strange wives, Ezra wanted everyone in all of the land to do the thing. Everyone who is a part of the Jewish faith, everyone who is part of God's people, of God's army, the Israelites, that they must also make that same declaration. So in verse number 7, when he made the proclamation, remember, as I shared, Artaxerxes gave Ezra all of the authority. And so with that authority, declaring that everyone shall come to Jerusalem in 3 days, he had that authority. And notice what it's in, as you recall, I shared that he was able to do. He had all of the law, all of the power, whatever the judgment was. He had the ability to appoint judges. He has also the ability to declare what punishment will be. Everything resided in Ezra. That is what his letter of authority gave him that power. And so as they made the proclamation throughout Judah and Jerusalem unto all the children of the captivity, that means all of the Israelites, and that they should gather themselves together unto Jerusalem. I mean, they, you all should gather and come to Jerusalem. And verse 8 says, and that whatsoever would not come within 3 days. If you're not there in 3 days, don't come in a week. Don't tell me you're too busy. Don't tell me you got to go and try some things. Don't tell me you got to plant your crop. Don't tell me whatever you got to do. You got to be here in 3 days. For if you are not here within 3 days, according to the counsel of the princes and the elders, which have demanded and required everyone to come, it says that your substance will be forfeited. Forfeited is when you give up something. Forfeit is you giving up. So it's not that it shall be taken away. You made a choice not to come. When you made your choice not to come, then that is on you. You lose your substance. And your substance was your land. Remember, God had given them all of the land. So if they choose not to be there in 3 days, they lose their land. They lose their land because they have made a declaration or a determination that they will not be part of God's army, or that they will not do what the man of God who has been instructed to come and to try to teach them and share with them what God's commandments is and where they have transgressed. If you're choosing not to do that, then you already have said that you're not part of Israel. You're not part of God's army. So that's why they use the word forfeited. And it says, and himself separated from the congregation. You will no longer be a part of Israel. You will no longer be a part of the tribe of one of the tribes of Jacob, one of the 12 tribes. You give up whatever you have because you have made a determination that you would not be in part, you will not do what Ezra would share to do. And Ezra's trying to teach them what God would have them to do. So that's what he says, that they would be separated from the congregation of those that had been carried away. And again, that is another name for the Israelites, because we know that the Jews were the ones that was carried away when Nebuchadnezzar took them over into captivity. Verse number 9, then all the men of Judah and Benjamin gathered themselves together into Jerusalem. So it says that everybody came. Everyone knew the authority that Ezra had, and everyone said that I do not want to forfeit all of the things that have my substance. I want to be there, and they all came. Now, as we're looking at this, so they were all there within the 3 days, and now it gives us a timeline of when this meeting occurred. This meeting occurred in the 9th month on the 20th day of the month. We know that the Jewish people start, their month starts in the spring of the year. Their month, we know their first month is where we celebrate, when we celebrate the Passover, which is right after the equinox with the first full moon. So we know that this is the ninth month is around December, and December is their rainy season, and we also know how the weather is in December. So it says that, and it shares with us that they were all there, and all the people sat in the street of the house of God, meaning that the crowd is so large, the people are there, but they all are meeting there at the temple. They're out in the street there at the temple. And now as it shares with us that they're meeting at the street, it says that they are trembling because of the matter. They're trembling because they know that they have sinned. They know that they have fallen short. They know that they have done wrong, and that because they have taken on these foreign wives, and that the others around them have taken on foreign wives. Let us understand, it may not be that everyone is doing it, but it's all a part of what's going on. And so by that, when God is going to make a move, and so all of them are there, and they know what's going on, they know why they are there, because the word is out that they have transgressed as a people against God. And so they are trembling because of the matter, and they are trembling because it's really pouring down rain. It's a heavy, heavy rain there, because it says for the great rain that's coming on. Now, verse 10, and Ezra the priest, he stood up, and Ezra the priest stood up and said unto them, declaring and letting them know, ye have transgressed and have taken strange wives to increase the trespass of Israel. All right, just letting them know that they have transgressed. And how have they transgressed? They transgressed by taking the strange wives, and by taking these strange wives, they have increased the trespass here is a transgression. They have increased the sins of the people that they have done. They've increased the sin that Israel has committed, because God had told them not to do it. God had punished them and sent them over to Babylon. And when they came back, it is as though they did not learn, because they then went and did the same thing by taking on these strange wives who have these different religions. And so it is as though they did not learn, and then you wonder, well, if you didn't learn from that one, then God will be even will definitely be more of a punishment. And so the people are there, they understand what they have done and what is going on, and they also know that as they are standing there, that this is a very serious situation, that they must repent. They must turn from the wicked ways and turn to serve the Lord. Verse 11, now therefore make confession. Now this is Ezra talking, and he shares for them to therefore make confession unto the Lord God of your fathers. The Lord, capital letters, L-O-R-D, to make confession unto him. Because when we confess our sins to the Lord is a forgiving God. He is a loving God. He is a merciful God. When we come before him and admit that we have sinned and fallen short, he will forgive us. And that's what Ezra is declaring. That's what Ezra is sharing. He said that now therefore make confession unto the Lord God of your fathers, the God that freed them out of Egypt, the God that gave them this land, the God that told them in Deuteronomy, do not take on any of these people. Do not be with them, for they have done all manners of evil, and God has taken the land from them and given it to Israel to be the light to the world, so that the world will know that the true and living God is the God, the true and living God of Israel, that is the one true God. And so as Ezra is sharing with them, and it says for them to make confessions to the Lord God of your fathers and do his pleasure. To do his pleasure means to do his will. Do what God has commanded. God gets pleasure when we follow his instructions. God gets pleasure when we do what is right. God takes notice and God loves us when we are doing what God would have us to do. God takes pleasure in that. He loved to see us doing good. God does not desire for us to do wrong and evil. So God gets no pleasure out of that. And so we should always want to please God and to provide pleasure to the Lord. And in the latter part of verse 11, and then Ezra is saying that the people have already promised, they've already accepted their leaders, the chief priests, the Levites, and the people that were around 3 days ago have said that they would do this. And now it's up to them who are standing there, who have this opportunity for them to now make a covenant with God. And a covenant is an agreement that they will do these things. They have realized the errors of their ways, and they are now going to repent and going to show some signs and going to do the right thing. And it says that, and separate yourselves from the people of the land. Separate from the people of the land. The people of the land, they are idol worshipers. They are the ones who God had already taken the land from them. Do not let them have any part of the inheritance of Israel, because they will come in and will change you, and you will not be serving the one true and living God. And it told them to separate yourselves from the people of the land and from the strange wives. Verse 12. Then all the congregation, all the men that were there, all of them that were there, the congregation answered and said with a loud voice. This loud voice means that they just wasn't saying it quietly. They said in a loud voice with a declaration of this covenant, because they know what has transpired in the past, how God had moved their foreparents and had taken the land and had destroyed Jerusalem and destroyed Judea, and how Judea was overthrown, had taken all those things. And so they knew that, God, if they did not return to God, that God has the power to raise up anything to come and overthrow them. And it says that, and the congregation answered and said with a loud voice, as thou hast said, so must we do. Meaning that they have entered into the covenant that they will put away all of these strange wives. They will put away these born to these strange wives. They will return to God. Now, It is not the foreigner. Again, it is the things that they were worshiping is what God told them to do. And see, God had already shared with them that these marriages were not legal marriages. And just as surely as they were married to those strange wives, there would be a Hebrew woman that would not have a husband. So they should be worshiping the same woman, worshiping the same God, whereas they are all together worshiping the one true and living God, where that whole house, and they don't have any idols or anything like that. And so that's what God wanted them to do, to be that close-knitted family together. And that's what Ezra was doing. And then, as I stated earlier, now the title of our lesson was Ezra, Faith and Action Preacher. He had the faith because he had the faith to step out, to come back to Jerusalem, had the faith, and God blessed him to have safe travels. And he is a man of action to come up there and to bring and to do all the things that he had declared as far as bringing in the gold back to the temple. But he's also a preacher sharing with them God's word. And he's also a man of action that says that we as the people have got to do something to get us back to worshiping the true and living God. We've got to push away all of these evils of the world. We can't serve God and serve these strange gods and have our one true living God with us. We must be 100% for God. And that's what he was telling them, and that's what he now has them doing, so that they can understand and realize that the reason that they were sent away into captivity before, the reason they had been made slaves over in Babylon, was because their foreparents had turned away from God. And so if they return to God, God will hear, God will answer, and they will be able to be in communication and be able to commune with God. Amen. So that will conclude our lesson for today. I certainly appreciate the attention. Thank you so much for joining in. Also, by way of announcements, I want to start sharing with everyone that on the fourth Sunday of this month, April the 25th, we will have St. James will celebrate our annual Men's Day. And with our Men's Day, our guest speaker will be Reverend Julian Jude. We had Reverend Jude here once before. He did a worship service for us at one of our sunrise services. So we now have the opportunity to hear him again for our Men's Day. Also, on the third Sunday, as we do all of our first and third Sundays, we're starting to do the meeting in the parking lot with the Park and Praise. Just wanted to remind everyone of that. And that will be it. And as we share with the Men's Day, that will be the fourth Sunday in April. Amen. With Reverend Julian Jude. All right. May we pray. Our Father in heaven, Lord, we thank you. God, thank you for being God all by yourself. Lord, we are trusting and, Lord, we're prayerful that we have tried to rightly teach your word. God, we ask that you, anything that was said incorrectly, God, please forgive me. And God, help me as I try to do better to teach your word. God, we also ask that you continue to bless and heal, because God, you have been a merciful God, and we thank you for all the things that you are doing. And God, we also, if I said something that was not correct, God, please forgive me for that. And Lord, help us to be about your business. God, we thank you for all the things that you have done. We thank you for this chance. Lord, we thank you for what you've been doing. And Lord, we're trusting that perhaps more people will be vaccinated and then we will be able to meet together face to face and be able to do all the things as we once were and once had. And God, we do not count it lightly. And God, we thank you again for being God all by yourself. God, this and many of the blessings we ask in your Son, Jesus the Christ's name. Amen. All right, thank you so much again for tuning in with us as we try to study God's word here at St. James Cumberland Presbyterian Church in America here in Decatur, Alabama. Thank you again. May God bless you. It's my prayer. Amen.